Psalm 57. Have mercy on me, O God, have mercy on me. For in you my soul takes refuge. I will take refuge in the shadow of your wings until the disaster has passed. I cry out to God Most High, to God who fulfills his purpose for me. He sends from heaven and saves me, rebuking those who hotly pursue me. God sends his love and his faithfulness. I am in the midst of lions. I lie among ravenous beasts, men whose teeth are spears and arrows whose tongues are sharp swords. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens, and let your glory be over all the earth. They spread a net for my feet, and I was bowed down in distress. They dug a pit in my path, but they have fallen into it themselves. My heart is steadfast, O God, my heart is steadfast. I will sing and make music. Awake, my soul, awake my harp and lyre, and I will awaken the dawn. I will praise you, O Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples. For great is your love, reaching to the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the earth. Let your glory be over all the earth. This is the word of the Lord.
Yes, this psalm is when David is in the cave and he's gone to hide from Saul because Saul is after him to kill him. David goes into the cave and he thinks that this geographical location is going to be his fortress, his security. He's going to be safe in there. But, you know, as he's there in the cave, Saul comes in and Saul relieves himself. So what David thought was a fortress to Saul was a bathroom. And David suddenly realized that it wasn't where we are geographically that gives us security in God. It's where we are in our relationship to God. And he says very early on in that little psalm, he says, I will take refuge under the shadow or in the shadow of your wings. And you know, it's that is the place we want to be. We want to be near to God's heart in our lives, in our purposes, what we do, how we behave. And if we're close to God's heart under the shadow of his wings, then it doesn't matter where we are geographically, we will be safe in him. I've just spent a month in Burma where we have over 1,400 children that we care for. We've been right up to the north to some precarious places. There are still wars going on in Burma, and although tourists can get in there okay, there are some very difficult places that we at Stand By Me get into. We've had our hotels trashed by secret police and been interrogated through the night and our passports taken. But you know, we've always had peace in our hearts because we knew God wanted us there. And it wasn't our geographical location that keeps us safe. It's where we are in God's purposes and where we are in God's plans. But David goes on to say wonderful things. And the little verse I want to leave with you, or half a verse I want to leave with you, is verse 3, where David says this. He says, God sends his love and his faithfulness. Did you know that? Did you know that? God sends his love and God sends his faithfulness. How does he do that? Well, we don't wake up in the morning. The postman comes about 1 o'clock in the afternoon. He used to come in the morning around with us. Everything changes. And expect to see a parcel of love, do you? On the doorstep. How does God send his love? Well, he sends it to us through people. I don't know how you came to faith in Jesus, but it was probably your mum and dad or a friend, somebody at work, an act of kindness. Something happened on a number of occasions, and slowly you came to the Lord Jesus. You came to faith in Jesus. Why? Because God was sending his love. You get talked into talking. Do you know we get smiled into smiling? You don't smile instinctively. Somebody comes up to the cart and goes, and you think, go away. What are you playing at? But eventually, that becomes a smile. We're read into reading. We're loved into loving. God sends his love. And I've realized that more and more. And what a privilege it is to be part of God's love. Your God's love to your neighbors. Your God's love to the people around. Your God's love to people in school, at work, on the train. We are God's love. And that's a wonderful privilege. But I've read this verse many times, but it says that God sends his love and his faithfulness. What a privilege to be God's faithfulness. And we are that. As we fulfill God's love, we are his faithfulness. That came home to me in a place called Dembidoli recently. And we've opened this school there. You'll see it in a few moments. And I'd been there about 3 or 4 days with the doctors examining all the children when 2 old gentlemen came onto the field. The kids ran out, put chairs for them. Their suits were clean but tattered. And they sat there in their suits on the field, and I was called for. I came out, and with a translator, I was told that these 2 gentlemen were local pastors from the neighborhood. Lovely old gentlemen. Dignity in poverty. And as I was sitting there chatting to them, thinking that we'd done all these wonderful things in Dembidoli over a course of 2 years, and we'd been praying, and God had been using us, etc. And the old pastor said to me, he said, "We've been praying that God would send his love and his light to this place for 12 years. They've been at it this long, and we've been at it about that long. But you know, when we arrived, we were God's faithfulness to them. Isn't that amazing? God used us to be faithful to them. God used us to bring his love to them. And you're doing that. We're doing that. And sometimes we don't even realize it, that we are part of God's love and part of God's wonderful faithfulness. When I was in Burma, I met a lad called Sim Kam Tuang. Now, some of you here sponsor some of our children. I just want to say thank you for doing that. You're changing lives. Radically changing lives. And this little fella, living up in Kalimeo, his father had died, his mum took his eldest sister, went off to India to try and make some money, the sister died, and mum was never able to return. This lad and his brothers, they lived with granddad. Granddad, in the words of Cam, he said, "My granddad treated us with contempt. He's a drunkard and a drastic man, dreadful. He sent us to cook alcohol, and he beat us many times without mercy. And one time when he beat my younger sister, she died. And I too nearly died, but I am recovered. So when these kids were suffering under this hardship, which he talks about here, they were told about our home in Kalemio. Somebody brought them along to our home. We took them in. We cared for them." And he'd been going to school for a while, but of course we can't do amazing things for all our kids in terms of what other children might be getting in school. And he saw kids in school getting lovely things. And he said, "Sometimes some words came from my deepest heart, asking why God let me be born from my mother to suffer the hardships of being an orphan." And then he got a sponsor in England. And do you know what he wrote? He said, "Then God let me meet you as my mother and father after I came to the orphanage or to the home. And I thank you so much because you are my good supporters and my sponsors. Thank you for providing so much for me. I know that my Father God heard all of my prayers when I cried out to him. And he changed my cry to joy because I received from you a hat and a photo and a Christmas card and a handkerchief and a warm coat and some colored pencils." And he said, "I received all these precious things for you from you because you are my good parents. And now I'm studying for my exams and I want to be an engineer." How did that come about? How was his life so drastically changed? Because God sent his love. God sent his faithfulness in a packet of colored pencils and a little hat and a sponsorship and somebody praying into his life and making him feel special. Another young lady I met in Burma is Vung. Vung lived in the mountains with her mum and dad. And then when she was 3, a tree fell on her father, who was a lumberjack. He died. And then her mum died when she was 10 from TB. And so she tried to look after herself, and she worked in the fields as a slave labourer. She tried even to go to school, and then it all became too tough. And then she wrote these beautiful words. I lived in a remote village up there in the Chin Hills. And life was difficult in those days. I had to stop school for a whole year due to financial difficulties. Now things are different. Since I joined the Sophia home, I have not been burdened with what is needed for life. Everything is here. All I need is here. Look, books and pencils and pens and bags and umbrellas and raincoats. I have never seen such that for sufficient for me before. I passed the matriculation examination, the thing I had dared not to dream of. If I were at the village, I would never matriculate. But now I'm attending Cali University, majoring in geography. I'm reading my second year course. And I want you to remember these wonderful words. A mere remote village girl attending university and about to be graduated with a BA degree. I have become somebody from nobody. I have become somebody from nobody. A mere mountain girl. Through the sponsorship program, through somebody loving her and caring for her. You know, not all our letters are that serious. I've got one here from Steve. Now, Steve is a bit of a rascal. You can tell he's a rascal. And he looks a rascal. And after you've been teaching 40 years, you can normally pick out the rascals. Steve writing to Mrs. Mary Davis in the UK from Yangon Children's Home. Thank you for your letter. I'm happy to see you. In your photo too. And then he wrote, you are old. Now I don't know how Mary Davis took that little bit. You are old. She's caring for this kid. She's loving him. She's sending £20 a month to meet all his needs. And he says, you are old. But then he wrote, but you're still looking good. In English, if any of you want to read it. Most of our kids read and speak English. So you're old but looking good. So our kids are sparky, you know, and they're the lucky ones. And there's literature over there about sponsorship if anybody wants to sponsor or support us. We even have some packs here if you want to go away with your own kid today. We're so good now you can even do that. You could take Kinesa, Kashuma, Tefera home. She's four. And a boy. Looks like a girl. So that's what we're doing. Okay, here we go. Let's take you quickly to Ethiopia. Do I point up there or do I point over there? Ah. We started our work in Ethiopia in 2005. Yeah, just 2005. And we were attracted to go out there by some church people who were caring for 220 children in a daycare centre, well, a school kind of thing. And do I point there? Shouldn't need to point anywhere, okay. Do I have to switch it on? Sorry?
Don't worry about that. Just remind you, Dave, you can teach IT at school.
Okay. I'll clip my fingers and you take it on quickly. Okay. So when we went to this place called Bekiji, which is where all the runners from Ethiopia come from, all their champions, because it's at 9,000 feet, quite a cold place. When we got there, we noticed that the children didn't smile. They had nothing to smile about. They were poor. Very little food and no education. So we met up with these church people who we'd heard about. This was their school. They were renting these two classrooms, and in each classroom there was 120 children. There were no books, there was no paper, there were no pencils, there was no food, no water, no toilets, nothing. But these kids would come to school early in the morning, and they would stay till about 1 o'clock when they had to go home, having sat in this oven for about 5 or 6 hours, keen to get an education. That was in 2005. These pictures were taken recently. Over those 7 or 8 years, we have been building the school, but as God has released funds to us, and we now have 480 children in the Beckerji school. We come to school every day and are keen to work. And this gives you an idea of the school. It also gives you an idea of our, down the far end there, the children's homes, where we have children 24 hours a day. And the children love to come to school. We've got good facilities. We've been helped by lots of people. So this is what the classrooms are like today. 40 children in the classroom with tables and chairs and books and even a little bit of science equipment. We take teachers out. We take books out to help to build the library. Now, these children were coming to school, but they weren't eating anything. Some of them wouldn't eat for days. And many of our children still, after having had their dinner on a Friday, don't eat probably very much till Monday morning. So we started giving them a full lunch. You can see they love it. It's something called anjira, which is a local crop, which is very nutritious. You can see the beautiful smiles on their faces. Life has been changing for these kids. But because they only had one meal a day and came for lunch, by 11:30, their brains were dead. You know, they needed something more to keep them going in the morning. So we introduced breakfast, and they will get there at 7. Breakfast is at 7:30, but they're all queuing outside the gate so they don't miss out. And they get a massive roll, bread roll. 500 are delivered every day, and they get a lovely hot cup of sweet tea. That gives them the energy that they need to study in the morning, and then have their lunch and go through the day. And our school lasts all day. It's not like the African school, two-shift system. It's a British system. We're trying to impact these people, this neighbourhood, to make a major change in the lives of the children. Now, on the left-hand side, you've got my son, Ahmed, who himself is a Stand By Me kid. I met him in 1983 in Beirut in the Civil War. I adopted him. He came over here. He has a first-class honours degree in computing science. He does all our technology. He runs the office. He could earn a fortune in the city, but he's passionate about bringing children to faith in Jesus Christ. And he travels around the world, and he does a great job. One day when he was in Beckerji, the police lady came to him and brought this little baby and said, "I want you to take this baby." And Ahmed said, "Well, what if I can't?" And the police lady said, "Well, if you can't, I'm going to have to put her back by the roadside where I found her." She said, "I've been in this town 13 months and I have found 11 children, and most of them have died because we had nowhere to take them. But you're here and I want to give you this baby." And of course, we took Grace, that's her name now. We took this baby, we called her Grace, and that's one of our doctors from Ireland who comes on teams with us. If any of you want to come on a team, just stand by me to Nepal or Ethiopia or other places, then just get in touch with us. We love taking teams. That is Grace just before Christmas. That's the same little girl. She would have been dead if it wasn't Stand By Me. Her name is Grace Ahmed. She named herself after Ahmed. And that's the surname she wanted. She insisted. He saved her life, and so that's her surname. And she's a bundle of fun. And she's sparky, she's going to school. But you know, she wouldn't be with us today if it wasn't for someone standing there to take the love of Jesus, to take his faithfulness. Because of that, this little girl is alive. So those are our three children's homes. Two of them are full, and we're working on filling the other one gradually as God brings orphans and abandoned children to us. And so they live right alongside the school. They go to school. And these are the children from just the first home that we had, Jane's home. And you can see all the girls there, can't you? And Corrie, the mum. Can you see one little lad in the middle? Talahan. He is just one brother with 11 sisters. What a life. They all look after him and spoil him and care for him. But you know, that little boy in his blue shirt there, he carried his brother on his back for 5 months while his brother died of HIV/AIDS. Carried him on his back. He was his doctor, his nurse, his friend, his dad, everything. And he felt sad when his brother died, because he had no one to love anymore. Totally alone in the world. So we knew we had to do something. And we had Grace as well. We wanted to find someone to care for Grace. And so the dear old lady on the right-hand side there in the green smock, that is Corrie. She's a Christian widow. We employed her. We set up a little home. And slowly we added the children. And then we built this lovely, proper, purpose-built children's home. But you know, do you see the young lady in the back, right in the middle? Her name is Sarah. It was Misery, but she's changed it to Sarah. Her and her two sisters, who were at the front row there, they lost their dad, he abandoned them, their mum died of HIV/AIDS. They were thrown out onto the road, they were abused by people. And at night, Sarah would follow the dogs, because she knew the dogs would be able to find her. And then one night the dogs turned on her, they ravaged her, and the two little sisters came to school the next day. And the teachers realised how bad the situation was, and so they came into our home, which was only a straw hut at the time. But slowly the children have grown, the families expanded, God has blessed us so we can build tiny homes with showers, and these kids are making wonderful progress. This is a young lady called Aribi, and you can see she's looking pretty sad and in a lot of pain. This picture came to me on a Friday afternoon in the office a couple of years ago, in November. And I text back to Becky and said, what's the story? He said, this little girl has just arrived on the school gates, and she's very poor. She's got a massive growth on her right arm. You can see it, can't you? Like a big football. Look to the left, that's how she should be. To the right. I'm not going to show you that picture, it's Alan. And so I said, well, why have you sent the picture? Well, she's in a lot of pain. She's not a stand-by-me kid. We don't know what to do. I said, well, we take her to a Salah hospital, get her operated on, we'll pay the bill. So they took her up to a Salah on the Friday evening, and she was on our hearts for a long time. We prayed for her. And then on Tuesday, we heard that the operation had been a success. They had taken off this rope, but unfortunately, they had to take off her right arm as well. Well, I was going out there 3 weeks later to Ethiopia, so I thought I would meet up with this little lass. But they sent us a picture on the Thursday. Look at that smile. That's the same girl on the Thursday, just a few days having had her arm taken off. Look at that smile. Why? Because God sends his love. God sends his faithfulness. And so she came out of hospital. I was in the home, and her mum arrived in the home with some elders. She's a Muslim here, with some elders, and her mum said to her, "You saved her life." I said, "No, I didn't. Jesus did. Jesus did." And then she said, "I'm going to give you a baby. I can't look after her. Our village is dirty. She'll die. I have 5 other children. I have no husband. I want you to take a baby." And so I personally sponsored the Rebe. We became great friends. I loved her to bits. And then when I went back, this time last year, in the March, Rebe wasn't in the home. We'd had lots of fun. She'd learned to draw very quickly. She'd never complained about losing her arm. But when I got back there last March, they told me that Rebe was back in hospital in Addis. I dashed up to Addis, she was in a bad way, and the oncologist told me that Aribi had maybe 2 months to live. No other thing we could do for her, he said, take her home and let her die with her friends. And so I stayed out in Ethiopia for 6 weeks with my little girl, and you can see she's having fun, she's done balloons, one is me in the middle there, David, I'm the good looking one, it's Dessa at the front there. Not so good looking. And this picture was taken maybe 10 days before The angels came on May the 9th, 3 a.m. in the morning, to take my little angel home. She's now safe in the arms of Jesus. That was the toughest assignment I've had for many years, nursing that little kid for 6 weeks, day and night, as she suffered with cancer of the lungs. But she's in heaven now. She died at 3 a.m. on May the 9th in the morning, and by 11 a.m. she was buried. Hundreds of Muslim men came to the funeral. Do you know why? Because they'd never seen love like this. We stood on the mountainside, and I was just weeping, and I was asked to preach to these guys. I was able to tell them about the love of the eternal God who loves us all, Muslim or Christian. Along with about 400 kids from the school, we stood on the mountainside and we buried the meal. Well, of course, I was angry at God. I gave God a hard time some nights at 2 a.m. in the morning. But you know, God was in it, and we can see that now. And so we have teams of doctors going out to examine the children twice a year. We have dentists going out at least once a year. They all pay their own way. Something else we do is provide water filter systems for every poor family. These are 99.9% clean water. We take teams out, they build them, and then take them out and present them. We also make our own flatbeds because they're too big to take through the door. And we build these beds and we take them out to these orphans and to these widows, and then we present them with the bed. We build it in the house, we take our light, and we build the bed, and then they think they're going to sleep on the boards, and then we get the mattresses delivered and the duvets and the pillows. And you can see the smile. See the old lady there on the right hand side? 70 years old, cried her eyes out. I said, "Why are you crying?" She said, "I've never slept in a bed before." 70. Same age as me, never slept in a bed. Now they all sleep in these beds. God sends his love. God sends his faithfulness, and we're privileged to be part of that. Well, we've been in Becketty for 7 years. God has done amazing things, but 2 years ago, God took us up to a place called Denby Dolo, even poorer than Becketty. And one of the main problems up in Denby Dolo is the water. And it's all polluted, so we have to help the people to get cleaner water. Another problem up there is the children don't have shoes. Few of them have shoes. Look at this little African foot here. People think African feet are like leather. They're not. They're not, they're the same as our feet. They suffer the same injuries, the same cuts, the same bruising. But into those little infestations go the worms, and different creatures get into their blood system, and then they have worms. Some of them have worms this long. We deworm our kids every 6 months, because otherwise the worms eat the food and they become malnutritioned and they die. And so that's just one little foot there. We go to places over here, like Next, and try and scrounge shoes off them. And we take shoes out, and water systems, and books, and we've been able to impact these people through very simple ways. So when we went into Denby Dolo just 2 years ago, we found there were so many children, over 1,000 children at risk on the streets or on the periphery of life in Denby Dolo. So we started a daycare centre for this group of kids here, mums with children out of wedlock, dear old widows struggling who were crippled a little bit, and then the little children there, and we started the daycare centre, and the daycare centre went really, really well. But we were only scratching the surface. We knew God wanted us to do more. And so we hired this place for the daycare centre, and we started to expand, and we took out clothes, and we took out treats. The kids started to smile, and we wanted them to go and have an education. Before I show you the schools, I'd like you to meet a little girl called Senna. And Peter's been doing a great job with the technology. And Senna is just one child. Now I put him under pressure. Senna's just one child in our daycare centre. Thank you.
arms wrapped around my finger, and it's so quiet in the world tonight. Little eyelids flutter 'cause you're dreaming, so I tuck you in, turn on your favorite nightlight. To you, everything's funny. You got nothing to regret. I'd give all I have, honey, if you could stay like that. Oh, darling, don't you ever grow up. Don't you ever grow up. Just stay this little. Oh, darling, don't you ever grow
up. Mama, what are you doing? I'm trying to stay this simple.
Stay this simple.
Saboda si kula si ganggalati karangko no shivi ni tinamera karangko na gadi na nimpoo. Saboda poo din policy tike si policy ni masagabe poo di gadi kuti si.
Just try to never grow up. Never grow up.
Saboda si kula si ganggalati karangko no shivi ni tinamera karangko na gadi na nimpoo.
In the car on the way to the movies, and you're mortified your mom's dropping you off. At 14, there's just so much you can't do, and you can't wait to move out someday and call your own shots. But don't make her drop you off around the block. Remember that she's getting older too, and don't lose the way that you dance around in your PJs getting ready for school. Just stay this little. Oh, darling, don't you ever grow up. Don't you ever grow up. It could stay this simple. And no one's ever burned you. Nothing's ever left you scarred. And even though you want to, just try to never grow up. You take pictures in your mind of your childhood room. Memorize what it sounded like when your dad gets home. Remember the footsteps, remember the words said. Favorite songs. I just realized everything I have is someday gonna be gone.
And yet she took Sarah home and cared for her till we came along and took the burden. God sends his love and his faithfulness. Next slide. This is a school in Denbigh-Dowley. Typical schools in Denbigh-Dowley, our kids can't even go to these schools. They're so poor. And so last year, we saved £80,000 to build a four-classroom school. And God worked an amazing miracle. A school went bankrupt down the road, five businessmen trying to make a killing, and they built this wonderful school worth between £400,000 and £500,000. They were bankrupt. The judge wanted to sell it for £133,000 for the authority to get their money back, and eventually he sold it to us as an auction for £80,000. Can you believe it? That was an amazing miracle. Not four classrooms, but 24 classrooms, 9 acres of land, running water, electricity. We could start educating the kids straight away, and here is the bundle of fun that we are looking after in Denbigh-Dowley. 240 children, and this was the opening last November. I was out there with three doctors, and kids all turned up for the opening. Of course, it left us with a dilemma, didn't it? We needed 240 sponsors for all these 240 kids. We now have 98, so we're on our way. But we still need 142 sponsors for the other children to get this ministry really running really well. So they now have nice classrooms, and they come to school. They have a Christian ed teacher. They have a resident nurse who's caring for their needs, and life has changed for these children. They even have school uniforms, thanks to the appeal that we had at Christmas time. And they all come, and they're all proud. our children, including little Sammy here, who now has a neat pair of crutches. And instead of Dad having to carry him around everywhere, he can come back and forth to school with no problems. Finally, just 2 minutes, the last film of a little girl called Birani. And Birani is another of our children, struggled with life in Nambidoli, but now life is a lot better for her. But you'll just see the reality.
This is Birhani. Birhani is 8 years old and lives in this little mud hut with her grandmother in Dembadola. Every morning, Birhani wakes up and walks approximately 1 mile from her home to this river where she collects her water. This is her only source of water, but it is not a source of life for Birhani. Unclean water sources affect over 1 billion people around the world like Birhani. And contaminated water contains tens of billions of bacteria and viruses which are responsible for the death of one child every 21 seconds. Oh,